fine with me. Yeah, kiss me like we died tonight. Holy cow, we'll be right. And only now I see the light. Yeah, lying with you half away. Oh, anyway, it's looking like it here.
You are the reason. give me the reason. Oh, to better all my ways. The beauty goes, the money spent, and everything else fades away. You are my constant. When we've walked the earth every inch and mile, left so hard until we cry, through every triumph and every trial, I will love you. Constant. You are my constant.
That the legal formalities are completed. My name is Hilary and I will be conducting the ceremony, which will be in accordance with the civil law of this country. This requires our couple to declare their freedom to marry each other before making the contract of marriage, and they take each other as partners for life. From earliest times, couples have sought to unify their individual lives through the security of marriage. Hopes, dreams, and aspirations are brought together on a wedding day to be shared and developed in order that the lives of both partners may best be fulfilled. Today, we see Bryn and Helen take what is a decisive and a momentous step, a step that will bring its challenges and its triumphs, its consolations and its rewards. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure Bryn and Helen would like to thank you all for coming to celebrate the beginning of their new life together. I'm sure it means a great deal to them that you can be here to share their special day and to witness their marriage vows. They have found in each other love and happiness, and they now wish to affirm their relationship. So you are here to witness the joining in matrimony of David Bryn Sherwin and Helen Katie Brunt. If any person knows of any lawful impediment to this marriage, they should declare it now. So now we'd just like to ask we've got Gareth, I believe, to come over and do a reading. And so if Gareth could possibly step up, please.
Yes, I'll marry you, my dear. And here's the reason why. So I can push you out of bed when the baby starts to cry. And if you hear a knocking and a creeping and it's late, I'll hand you the torch, you see, so you can investigate. Yes, I'll marry you, my dear. You may not apprehend it, but when the tumble dryer goes, it's you that'll have to mend it. You'll have to face the neighbour should a Labrador attack him, and if a drunkard fondles me, it's you that'll have to whack him. Yes, I'll marry you, my dear. You're virile and you'll leave. My house is a pigsty. You can help me keep it clean. That sexy little dinner which you serve by candlelight. As I do chipolatas, you can cook every night. It's you that has to work the drill and put up curtain track. And when I've got PMT, it's you that gets the flat. I've do see great adventures, but none of them for you. And before you change your, and before you see the light and change your mind, I do.
Before you're joined in matrimony, I have to remind you of the solemn and binding character of the vows you're about to make. Marriage, according to the law of this country, is the union of two people voluntarily entered into for life to the exclusion of all others. It is also a solemn union to provide the love, friendship, help and comfort that each ought to have for the other, both in times of joy and in times of difficulty, not to be entered into lightly nor lightly put to one side. So I'm now going to ask each of you in turn to declare that you are free to marry. And, Karin, we will start with you. So if you could please repeat after me. I do solemnly declare that I know not of any lawful impediment why I, David Gwynne Sherwin, may not be joined in matrimony to Helen Katie Brown. Thank you. Now Helen is your
turn. I do solemnly declare
that I know not
of any lawful impediment
why I, Helen Katie Brunt, may not be joined in matrimony
to David Gwynne Sherwin.
Thank you very much. So ladies and gentlemen, our couple are about to make their vows to each other. So for those of you who are able to, I would ask you to please stand. So, if you'll just turn to face each other, hold each other's hands. Okay, so Bryn, as you make your vows to Helen, please take her hands and repeat after me. I call upon these persons here present. To witness that I, David Bryn Sherwin, do take thee, Helen Katie Brunt,
to be my lawful wedded wife.
Thank you. And if you keep hold of Bryn's hands and you repeat after me. I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I, Helen Katie Brunt.
Do take thee, David Bryn Sherwin, to be my lawful wedded husband. And Bryn and Helen would like to also now share with us some personal vows. So Bryn, if you repeat these.
Hi. David Bryn Sherwin, take you, Helen Katie Brunt, to be my wife, my partner in life, and my one true love. I will cherish our union, and I will love you more each day than I did the day before. I will trust you, laugh with you, and cry with you, loving you faithfully through good times and bad, regardless of the obstacles we may face together. I give you my hand, my heart, and my love, from this day on, for the rest of our lives.
I, Helen, take you, Bryn, to be my husband, my partner in life, and my one true love. I will cherish our union, and I will love you more each day than I did the day before. I will trust you, laugh with you, and cry with you, loving you faithfully through good times and bad, regardless of the obstacles we may face together. I give you my hand, my heart, and my love from this day on for the rest of our lives.
So it is also part of a long tradition of marriage in this country and in many other parts of the world that the marriage contract is sealed by the giving and the receiving of a ring. The wedding ring is an unbroken circle, it has no beginning and it has no end. It symbolises everlasting love and is an outward sign of the lifelong promises that you are making to each other today. So if we could ask Arthur, please, with Tosh to come over to the front. Helen's hand and place the ring on her finger. Don't push it on entirely yet. Then you can repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
And a symbol of our friendship.
And a symbol of our friendship.
And everlasting love for each other.
And everlasting love for each other.
Everything I have.
Everything I have.
And everything I am.
And everything I am.
Is yours from this day forward.
Is yours from this day forward.
It's warm. It will go on. Thank you very much. Now, if you've got daddy ring.
Just a moment.
Okay, so Helen, if you could please take Bryn's ring and place it on his finger and repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
And a symbol of our friendship.
And a symbol of our friendship.
An everlasting love for each other.
An everlasting love for each other.
Everything I have.
Everything I have.
And everything I am.
And everything I am.
Is yours from this day forward.
Is yours from this day forward.
No, going back now. Thank you. Bryn and Helen, you have both made the declarations required by law, and you have made solemn promises and a binding contract with each other in the presence of your witnesses, your family and your friends. Today is the start of a new life together. We hope that the love you feel for each other will deepen and grow stronger throughout the years to come. It gives me great pleasure and I declare that you are now husband and wife, and you know what to do.
This is very originally entitled Helen and Bryn. They met way back when in 2010. Both of them out in St Albans one night, their paths did cross, and Bryn thought, she's all right.
Bryn took her number and asked her on a date. It's lucky he's a patient man, as her reply came 10 days late.
But they soon started dating and she grew even keener. And before long she had fallen for her handsome window cleaner.
In their early years together, while they were young and free, they visited New York City and swam in Thailand's crystal clear sea.
In more recent years, they've settled for UK holidays, including Bryn's most favourite place, Walton-on-the-Naze.
Helen loved a night out with the girls and Bryn watching Match of the Day, but they're at their happiest slumped on the sofa eating a Domino's takeaway.
In their home in Welling, Helen's not quite domestic goddess, but Bryn has learnt to live in her organised mess.
They have grown their gorgeous family, who they adore like crazy. They're Elsie, Boo and Arthur, and not forgetting Daisy.
They went to Rome in 2016, a romantic break for three. Bryn finally popped the question and got down on one knee.
3 years later, on the 4th of July, their wedding should have been, but something got in the way. Yes, COVID-19.
But here we all are on this day of love and laughter to see you tie the knot and wish you happy ever after.
Thank you very much. We're just now going to have, there'll be a few minutes, we're going to have some music play and we're just going to sign the schedule. So if I could ask the witnesses to come forward, please. Mr. and Mrs. Sherwin.
Say, party up. every day and I'm feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. I'm feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be
and gentlemen, pray silence, please. Can you please take your seats? Ladies and gents, please be upstanding for the bride and groom. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, I'm feeling a little bit nervous at the moment. It's a big day. Obviously, there's no sort of guarantees. We're in the last 16. Anything can happen. come on. I mean, obviously, I've only been told to do this a couple of days ago, so I haven't really got much sort of written down or anything. I did run through a few things last night in the pub with Phil, and he sort of said, no, you can't say that, because I'm saying that. So he's going to make a better fist of it for me. Obviously, judging by his haircut, he's got a pretty good sense of humour. So, right. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the brother of the bride, Phil.
Cheers. Like Danny said, my name is Phil. I'm Hel's little brother, and I think we'd all agree we should absolutely love you today. Absolutely, give a round of applause. I mean, much of it you can say, the hair, the makeup, the dress, you know, but essentially the person who walked down next to her in the aisle really elevated her to another level, I think, to be honest, you know. Absolutely beautiful, but don't be fooled by her exterior. Growing up with her, she was incredibly sneaky, very devious. Arthur, wherever you are, listen up, okay? Listen well. Are you there, Arthur?
No.
He's there. Yeah, there were a lot of wars between us. I suppose the psychological warfare. She'd stand at the top of the stairs and just scream, "Ow! Phil, stop it!" I'd just go, what? And then I'd get a shout up the stairs, I'd be sent to my room, she'd be there smiling away, as ever. And I'd get the bollocking, it was terrible. Every time she did that. And then the physical warfare as well. I mean, you know, close quarters. She was vicious. You had to Arthur, keep your distance away. The apple does not fall very far from the tree, I'm telling you, okay? Keep your distance. Close quarters, she'd grab anything. Hair, skin. She made me a biter. How's your shin? All right? That mark on your shin, is that gone?
Just.
That's a shame. Never mind. I mean, she was a great sister, though. She really was. We went away to Menorca, 1999. Just you, me, mum and dad. That was it, just us two. And I was only, I think I was 13 or 14 or so. So all that San Miguel, I couldn't quite manage. It was 10 o'clock. And felt terrible. I had to go home, you know. And then she just said, just throw up, get it out. Strategic vomiting. Oh, it's not a bad idea. 10 o'clock came every night, threw up. That was early hours, you know, brilliant. But it wasn't all altruistic at all, not at all. Because the rule was if we went out together, we had to come home together. And so, of course, rather than coming home at 10 o'clock, she'd come home at 2 or 3 o'clock with me, intact. A little less weight on me, you know. So now, whenever I do any sort of tactical chundering, I'm always thinking of you. Just so you know, whenever I'm doing that, you know. But like I said, she is a fantastic sister. There's two others, you know, she's got to compete with. I think she's the best one. I mean, the other two, the first one came along, the second came along, outstanding at school, very intelligent, you know, very pleasing, you know. Helen came along, thank God for that, you know, the bar suddenly went right down low. And I was like, whew, A-level results day. Oh, yes! I mean, I was sorted. All I had to do was nothing really, just a bare minimum. I was walking, you know. Just don't, you know, don't mess up, don't impregnate anyone, and you'll be fine. And of course, that went out the window, didn't it? But never mind. But what can you do? What can you do? But, no, but she, it turned out all right, I suppose. You know, we got there in the end, and everything's all right. It doesn't matter what happened when we were kids. We grew up and you know, brother and sister, we go for it, don't we? Yeah, I think so. Don't agree, you know, just sit there and, you know, have a blank expression, I don't care. That's fine. Anyway, so I met Bryn the first time, we've been out for quite a while, and we went for a walk around Shenley Tea Rooms with Daisy, and never met Bryn before. Mum said, oh, he's a lovely fellow. But then, you know, that's quite a bland sort of thing, isn't it? You know, we're going to make out of that, so we thought we'd make our own minds up, you know. He went off and he's a nice guy, you know, get past the ears. He's a great guy, you know, get past that, you're looking good, you know. But we went walking and the kids, Layla must have been about 12, 13 maybe, and obviously the kids were less as old as that, wherever the word may be. And yeah, exactly. And Dave was walking along and some horny mutt went past and tried to hump her from behind. And Bryn did nothing, he just he let the moment pass. I thought, there's a man you want in a crisis situation. You know, he didn't panic, he did absolutely fuck all. But he didn't panic, okay? That's the main thing. Yeah, very good, lovely guy. I think the measure of the man as well is the friends he keeps as well. We went on the stag do last year. Great bunch of lads, all across the board. The afternoon naps were an absolute brilliant idea. Never had that before. 4 o'clock came, had 3 hours yourselves, lads. Rest up. I was like, ooh, that's not a bad idea. And everyone loved it, you know. But, no, I mean, it's, as a couple, I think they're absolutely fantastic. Everyone would agree on that. Come on. They've walked into parenthood as if through a doorless doorway, just step right through, nice and easy. Considering the mouth on Elsie and the tantrum king that is Arthur, they manage it particularly well. I think it's absolutely brilliant, you know. Let's have a look at my notes now. I missed loads of it, actually, Jesus. I put Weaver cracking and nothing after that, and all that's going to be there. But anyway, there we are. It's been delayed, obviously, because of COVID, and there's a lot of people who would love to be here, Mum particularly, obviously can't be with us anymore, but she'd be ever so happy to see you guys tie the knot. She's always spoke so highly of you, Bryn, more than just he's a nice guy. She went beyond that afterwards, you know, and saying how great you were and this and that and everything. Never clean my windows, but you know, you were alright. Every single car, I'm dropping hints left, right and centre. Oh, I can't see through that one. Unbelievable, you know. There we are. But no doubt, I mean, Mum's up there looking down on us, telling me to hurry up so Bryn can fuck up his speech and Bruce can relay into him, you know. Everyone's waiting for that, really, aren't they, you know. But in the meantime, let me grab my drink. Please, guys, charge your glasses to the lost loved ones, the absent friends, my lovely sister, the beautiful bride, my big-eared brother-in-law. Bryn and Helen.
Thank you, Bill. And next up, the bride. Woo! Helen, where are you going? I've got a sofa.
Let me have a moment.
Obviously, she's looking awesome tonight. A little bit too awesome. I'm pretty gutted that Bryn's marrying her, to be honest. Probably an opportunity for some sort of affair down the line. Once she sort of realises she's got zero ambition. Lack of personal hygiene and average genitalia. But you already know that, so that won't be coming as a surprise. Anyway, over to the bride. Thank you.
Hello, hello. I'm just doing some very quick thank yous because I know that Bruce is chomping at the bit to get the mic, so I won't be very long. I'm just going to do some thank yous. So first of all, I don't know if Dave is in here anywhere, Dave that runs Minstrel Court. But I wanted to thank Dave because he has just been amazing trying to plan this day. He's been so calm. He's made me stay calm and I've flapped at him. So thank you, Dave, wherever you are. And I want to thank my sister-in-law, Holly. Stay where you are. Because she is doing the biggest thing of all and having my kids overnight tonight. So thank you so much, Holly and Tosh. I don't think Tosh is going to do much tonight, but thank you anyway. And thank you for all your support in the run-up to today. It was very appreciated. Thank you. And I also want to thank my other sister-in-law, Bryony, along with Jenny and Neve, who have helped with all the decorations today. So all the lovely bits and pieces around the room they all did this week. So thank you, girls, very much. And Bryn's parents, Ian and Paula. I'm going to get emotional now. Thank you both very much for welcoming me into your family from the day I met you. And thank you for being wonderful grandparents to our children. We all love you very much, so thank you. And thank you to all my lovely nieces and my sisters today. Isabella, Layla, Neve, Luna, who have I missed? Anyone else? Jenny and Sarah, thank you all so much for being with me today. But especially my sisters, Jenny and Sarah. They have had to plan 4 hen do's. They've had to cancel 2. We had 1 on Zoom, which they bought loads of chocolate to. And yeah, and we had a lovely weekend in Skeggy. So thank you girls so much for everything you've done. I could go deeper, but I'll just cry the whole time, so I'll leave it at that. And Phil, thank you very much for being by my side today in the absence of any living or willing parents. Thank you. And thank you to my husband, Bryn. Just thank you for everything. Thank you for being with me through everything we've been through. Couldn't have done any of it without you. Good times and the bad. So I love you and thank you. And also another just nod to my mum, who obviously couldn't be here today. But she did love Bryn very much, and she'd be really happy that this was happening today. She was at the last one, so it's fine. So if you could raise a glass to my mum, to Angela. Thank you.
Well done, Hills. Right, next Bryn, obviously Bryn's, we played football for about 20 years together, Sunday League, and he knows that I could absolutely destroy him right now because I was a horrible bastard on a Sunday morning. But I'm going to leave that to Bruce because he's going to be doing that in about 2 minutes. So here's Bryn.
Thanks. Cheers. I was expecting the character assassinations to come at the end with the best man, but let's go for it all the way through, that's fine.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Phil, for those kind words, what it says here, but prick. For stepping in to be dad for the day, we do appreciate it. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, Bruce. On behalf of my wife and I, I'd like to thank you all for being here on our special day. It really wouldn't be the same without you. It'd be a lot cheaper. I hope you're enjoying your day so far. There's going to be a number of toasts during my speech, so please make sure your glasses are full. My aim is to get you so drunk you can't remember a thing Bruce says in his speech. You've heard it all before from everyone else anyway, so where do we go from there? I don't know. It's great to be in a room full of people. Thank you all for making the effort to be here today. Special mention to the Edgars, who've jumped through many hoops to be here today, from Texas. COVID tests, isolation, the lot. So thank you guys for making the effort. We love that you're here. There's a few people I want to mention who sadly couldn't make it today. Our dear friend Doug.
He's
here in spirit. He's here on the phone. Hi, Doug.
Hey, Doug.
and his lovely wife Gemma. Many of you know Doug, and you know he's been diagnosed recently with a terrible illness and is currently undergoing treatment. So our thoughts are with him and his family. We know you'll smash it, Doug. We know you will. Originally, I had two best men for today, sadly, Ben and Jade have been unable to make it after an absolutely horrendous week for them both, which has ended up in Jade being in hospital. So our thoughts are also with them and the lovely Jade to make a swift recovery. And obviously our biggest regret is that Helen's dear mum Angela isn't here to share in our joy. She would have loved today, and she'd have been in her element getting to know everyone over a nice glass of wine. So it's a huge loss today that these great people aren't here with us. And if you could just raise your glasses one more time for absent friends.
Absent friends.
Absent friends. Absent friends.
Yeah. Cheers.
Doug's got a glass of mint.
Matcha too.
Nice.
Matcha too.
Cardamom and turmeric.
Lovely. I want to say a big thank you to my ushers, Ian, Julian, and my brother Tosh. Thanks for all your help today, making everything run smoothly, and all you've done in the lead up for today, and for, quite frankly, some of the finest ushering I've ever seen. Truly, truly world-class ushering. So, thank you, boys. I'd like to thank Helen's wonderful family, Jenny, Stu, Sarah, Tom, Phil, and Bryony, and all their awesome children for making me feel very welcome into your family from the moment I met you all. If you haven't met them yet, do introduce yourself. They really are the best of people. I'd like to thank my mum and dad for everything they do for us, for all the love and support you've given us over the years, and for being the most amazing grandparents to our beautiful children. We love how much they love you. When I first introduced Helen to my parents, I warned her that my mum would chew her ear off and do all the talking. And my dad would probably just say, "Oh yeah, yeah, alright," and then take a cup of tea into the next room to watch Country File. But I was wrong. For the first time, I've never seen my dad talk so much and be so chatty to any girl that I've brought home. It's the ultimate seal of approval. I also want to thank you for raising such a handsome, intelligent, funny, well-rounded legend of a son.
Well done, Gary.
Unfortunately for Helen, Holly married him. But we all know it could have been worse. I've got to talk a little bit about my new wife now. I met Helen on a night out in St Albans, Steve Baker's birthday do. It was our second party of the day, because that's the way we used to roll. Sure, the first party was for one-year-olds in the Lawson's back garden, but party's a party. So there we were, at our second party of the day. I saw Helen from across the room. Now, those of you that know me... Those of you that know me best know that I've always been very smooth with the ladies. I mean, that wasn't a joke. Meeting Helen went with my usual smoothness. I saw her chatting to a mutual friend, Anna Baker. She came over to the bar next to Ben and I. So I asked her who that girl she was talking to. I asked her what her name was. She told me her name, and I asked if that fella that she was there with, she was out with a guy called Matt Tomlin, some of you know him, whether that was her fella. Well, before I got an answer, flung her arms in the air and just steamed across the room straight to Helen, and I cringed as I watched her from the other side of the room point at me, and I swear I saw her mouth the words, "My friend really fancies you," as I've been back on the playground. Like I said, smooth, like sandpaper. Another one bites the dust, I thought, but later that evening I did get to talk to Helen, convinced her to give me her number. And after 10 days of pretty relentless pestering, 10 days, you made me wait, she finally agreed to go on a date with me. The first date went very well, which surprised Helen. And many more followed. I introduced her to all my friends and family. Obviously, everyone loved her. Some even said I was punching. She is, after all, a beauty. Then more people said I was punching. Then some more. And then it finally dawned on me that I'm probably not as good looking as I thought. This was confirmed when Helen revealed her celebrity list to me. You know the list, the one we all have of the five celebrities' crushes. The top two on her list at the time I met her were John Terry and Gordon Ramsay. So sure, my wife fancies ugly blokes. We got on like a house on fire, and as time went by, we saved and bought our first house together, got a dog, talked about starting a family. And when you're with someone for 11 and a half years, you inevitably have ups and downs. And as most of you know, having children was not straightforward for us. But after 4 years, an ectopic pregnancy, serious operation, rounds of IVF, our biggest up finally arrived, and our beautiful miracle baby daughter was born. We couldn't have been happier, and I know that everyone here shared our joy. But then, 3 days after the best moments came the worst moments, with the tragic and sudden loss of Helen's wonderful mama, Angela. The reason I bring this up is because when you see someone you love going through the hardest time of their lives, and you're next to them as they come out of the other side, you learn an awful lot about that person's character. And I witnessed in Helen such strength and an inward determination not to allow this horrible experience to keep her down. I was in awe of the courage you showed and the spirit you showed. And all throughout the whole thing, you never lost your sense of humour. You always welcomed people into your house, however bad you were feeling. And you were just heroic throughout that time. You can't go through something like that without it changing you. And the person that came out the other end is, I think, the best version of yourself. You've not got time for negativity in your life. You surround yourself with such positive people. You've got a wonderful group of friends that keep you happy. They're happy people. They're wonderful people. You do lots of work for charity, from helping in shelters and food banks to, at the moment, she's a butterfly at the Lister Hospital, where she'll go and sit with terminally ill patients that have nobody else, that nobody visits. And even this week, the week of our wedding, we've got so much to do. She absolutely had to go and do her shift at the hospital. The kind of woman she is. She's amazing. Some of you may have read a blog Helen wrote, a really raw, emotional and honest piece of writing about her experience of losing her mum. And that blog, writing that blog, has been read and shared on the internet, and Helen's actually sat down with complete strangers to try and help them through similar experiences. It's a great example of just how enormous your heart is, and I'm privileged to have my place in it. I think you're incredible. Along with our wonderful children, Elsie and Arthur, who you are an amazing mum to, you are without a doubt the best thing that's ever happened to me. My life is infinitely better with you in it. I know how lucky I am, mainly because everybody always tells me how lucky I am. You are awesome, and I love every single thing about you, and I am insanely proud to be able to stand here today and call you my wife. If you could all be upstanding for this one, and raise your glasses, please, to my wonderful and fabulous wife, Helen Sherwin.
Helen Sherwin!
But I just want to say a quick word about my best man. Bruce I've known since I was 11 years old, but I met him on the first day of school. We've been friends forever, but that's not the reason I chose him to be my best man. Bruce simply doesn't let the truth get in the way of a good story. So whatever you do, do not believe a word of what you're about to hear.
Well done, Bryn. A bit soppy, but man up a bit. Come on. Right, obviously main event now, Mr. Bruce Brunson. It's not a circus act. He's a human. Giantism is a curse.
Even though, don't worry if you don't laugh at any of his speech, he will. Okay, so it's all good. Here he is, Mr. Bruce Brunson.
Nearly forgot my paperwork. Comedy gold. Right. Well, that was quite exhausting, wasn't it? Really, really impressive speeches. I'm amazed at Bryn's ability to speak. Right, actually. Oh, I have never seen that. As Bryn says, I've known him for 33 years, and I am absolutely shocked at how heartfelt and lovely that was. So I'm not going to kick you in the nuts on this one. That was absolutely lovely, Bryn, and you nearly made me cry. Anyway, clearly that's enough of the niceties. So, I mean, obviously it is great to be here to celebrate this wonderful day with all of you, and it was obviously touch and go, it was going to happen. Where was Bryn in October 2019? I believe he was in Wuhan, messing around with his chemistry kit, and even then he only managed to delay it by 1 year. but there you go, we are here at long last. So for those of you who don't know me, there's been enough pressure put on this, hasn't there? Jesus Christ. I'm Bruce, and I'm actually one of two best men. Unfortunately, I mean, we spoke about this. Ben, let's call him the other one, can't be with us today for the reasons that that Bryn said, and we're very saddened about that, and we do wish Jade a speedy recovery. However, as luck would have it, I now have the station myself. Boom. Every cloud, I love a bit of limelight. So I'm just going to suck this in. Right, so... And in all honesty, Ben was always the sideshow. He was more like Debbie McGee to my Paul Daniels, or Boris Johnson to my Dominic Cummings. Ultimately, I'm the brains and talent behind this double act, and Ben was more the eye candy. However, those that do know him will have realised that he had a recent Achilles injury and he was hobbling around on crutches. So I would have referred to him as sort of more Paralympic eye candy. So ultimately, it hasn't taken too much away from the speech. Now, two best men. Pretty extravagant, I think, don't you? Even though it's only me today. So Bryn must be incredibly popular to have two best men. No. I'm afraid not. Bryn actually only has two friends, and that's me and Ben couldn't be asked to show up. It's so much harder to choose one best man when you only have two friends. And to be honest, I was really hoping you'd just pick Ben. Of course, I didn't mean this. I love a bit of public speaking. And he knew that. And I am very, very happy to be part of this special day. A question does sit very heavy in this room, though. How the hell did Bryn manage to dupe a woman like Helen into marrying him? And more importantly, how did Bryn end up with an amazing friend like me? There's only one explanation, and it is pity. Again, I'm joking. I know it's hard to believe, but Bryn is actually very popular, particularly with the ladies. Yay! Now, this isn't in a sort of rip your clothes off kind of way. This is more of a knitting circle, drinking coffee, talking about your feelings, group cry kind of way. Best description of Bryn is the gay one out of my best friend's wedding, but he doesn't have the looks, dance moves or charisma. His popularity appears to be that he crosses the gender divide through female understanding and empathy, and he sits with his legs crossed. Either way, no girls' night out is complete without a social media post of Bryn with Tamsin, Jude, Jules and Sarah. So despite these strange, let's call them untraditional girl-leaning traits, I've known Bryn for a very, very long time, and believe me, he hasn't always been this popular. To emphasise this, we will go back to the beginning. Mine and Bryn's beginning was in September 1988. I was sat in a classroom with 29 other kids on my first day at Stanborough School. Glancing around, I saw many fresh faces. A couple of them are here with us today. Tamsin, my now wonderful wife, would you believe it? Julian, there, filming over there. And Dougie, who's on the other end of that phone. So love you, Dougie. You know? Each of them was...
Don't worry about me.
Oh, yeah. And Jules. I've mentioned you once already. Were you hogging? Exactly, exactly. Each of them, actually, there you are, Julian. Each of them smiling nervously back at me. Right. I then happened upon a very large pair of ears. Puzzled, I looked more closely and saw that these ears were actually attached to a skinny boy. Then I saw the feet. Really big feet to match the ears. A clown in his spare time, maybe. A water skier, surely. Whatever he was, he needed a friend. So I approached him and introduced myself. His name was David Bryn Sherwin. Bryn to his friends. No one had called him Bryn. I would be the first. So, from 11 years old, Bryn and I were thrust together at the same form at school, where we spent our entire time during secondary school. Our house was called Ash, which may explain why we both went on to become such fabulously accomplished smokers. And despite Bryn's heavy smoking, thankfully it didn't stunt his growth, and over time he grew into his ears and feet. Nearly. This new-grown confidence spread into his sporting prowess. Ever the sportsman, Bryn was a keen competitor, and his confidence generally turned into an angry, shouty, grumpy pants on the football pitch. Although he was witnessed shouting, "Sexy as ball," when ladies were present once. Although he always claimed it was Paul McCormack.
That's actually true.
And despite his regular moaning about his grinding knees, hurty hips, gnarly feet, he was apparently a must-pick for the school and Barron football teams. But he wasn't just an expert in run-of-the-mill sports either. He was a founder of Bucketball. Yeah. This consisted of throwing a ball into a bucket. He was a serial winner at Penny Up the Wall, throwing a penny closest to the wall, not to be confused with Spend a Penny Up the Wall. He was part of a deadly partnership with Ian at Scrim Whipping. For those that don't know, this consists of whipping people with a wet rag. This can draw blood, and regularly did from Parks, Mark Harley and Doug. And of course, he was the expert's expert at Ua sehr gut. This was a German table tennis drinking game where you had to shout Ua sehr gut every time you hit the ball. I know that's weird, but Bryn excelled at it.
Because if he was good at it, he didn't have to drink a shot.
Correct. So despite all this sporting prowess, Bryn is actually a bit of a wuss. He's not one to back down to a direct challenge to his manliness on the football pitch or in the pub, but he is a massive tart when it comes to spiders and a dentist. On one occasion, we discovered him crying in the corner of a bathroom after Ian had been pushing spiders under the door. Or the time he ran screaming and smashed a hole in my living room door when running away from Incy Wincy, our friendly house spider. Bryn's fear of the dentist was just as strong. For years we had to look at Bryn's snaggletooth gnashers, sporting a yellowish brown hue because he was too scared to go. In the end, it was Helen who ordered him to put on his big boy pants and go see the dentist to sort things out. A relief for anyone who had to look at it. I think, however, that we can all agree he looks pretty good now. Yay! A pre-wedding starvation diet has helped with the squidgy bits he had around the middle. And age has clearly matured and chiselled his looks, although you can park a bike in the creases of his forehead. So even though he may look good now, Bryn did go through some wilderness years in his late 20s. We fondly refer to this amongst our group of friends as the TV Sherwin period. This period mainly consisted of Bryn doing the following. Sitting in front of his TV, drinking tea, ordering pizza, smoking fags, and watching Gladiator. Now, we're not talking Ulrika Johnson and John Fashu Awuga gladiators. We're talking a general who became a slave who became a gladiator who defied an emperor. Bryn had a major Maximus man crush, and he still has the outfit. Which I'm pretty sure Helen must be familiar with. Needless to say, this behaviour had a detrimental effect on both his physical and mental health. Physically, he piled on the weight. At one stage, he resembled Sloth from the Goonies. The extra weight did smooth out some of the wrinkles on his forehead, though. However, the true impact was on his mental health. Apart from waddling around the football pitch once a week, he did sod all. He became like Jabba the Hutt. He could be found laid prone on the sofa while people visited and put the kettle on for him. A full intervention was needed. He was told he would remain single forever and become a weirdo, well, more of a weirdo, if he didn't address this. Thankfully, he took the advice and chose to reduce the calories, go outside and interact with people again. And thank God he did, otherwise he wouldn't have met Helen and I wouldn't be friends with him anymore. Now, Bryn has had girlfriends prior to Helen, and most of them I didn't think much of, and generally I ignored them. My first meeting with Helen was different. Having eventually established that the woman in his kitchen was his new girlfriend, great introducing, Bryn, you know, I realised he'd struck gold. She was gorgeous, funny, and more importantly, she laughed at all my jokes. My favourite by far, a keeper. Bryn was bound to fuck this up. But somehow he didn't. He's managed to hoodwink Helen into believing that he's the keeper, and they are now the proud parents of two wonderful children, a fabulous home, and a very, very happy life. This is the only chink in Helen's impeccable armour, judgement. Let's be honest, Helen's the fun one. I literally have to force 3 pints of Bulmers down Bryn's neck on a night out, whereas Helen leads the charge to the bar and the dance floor. So not only is Bryn lucked out with some awesome friends...
Yay!
Right, now there's a, I wrote, pause for friends to go where hey. So, right, let's do that again. So not only has Bryn lucked out with some awesome friends,
yay!
Better, he has somehow married into further popularity by riding onto Helen's shirt tails. Now, despite all this...
Easy for you to say.
Right, so despite all this, they are a wonderful pairing. And to be honest, part of my job is, as best man is to ensure that this marriage remains happy and healthy. I will do this by imparting some sage marital advice. The mantra for marriage enlightenment consists of 4 compromises that were passed on to me by the Dalai Lama when I had a beer back with him in 1988.
Tamsin's listening carefully.
These are the original... These are the original post-its that the Dalai Lama gave me. Item number 1. Ensure your wife has her own personal time and space so she can concentrate on herself and feel peace in the wonderful home she's created. The Dalai Lama says you should accommodate this by going to the pub. Number 2. Ensure your wife the chance to spend time with her friends so they can relax and discuss any worries or concerns they may have without judgment and influence. The Dalai Lama says you should accommodate this by going to the pub. However, occasionally, Bryn will show up. Number 3. On the marriage mentor enlightenment. Ensure your wife has quality time with the children on her own, so they have the love of their mother undisturbed by any other external presence. The Dalai Lama says you should accommodate this by going to the pub. And finally, ensure your wife has freedom in the kitchen to expand her culinary skills and develop her recipes. The Dalai Lama says you should build her a new kitchen and then go to the pub.
You followed them exactly.
Now, this is not an exhaustive list. This is stage 1 to marriage enlightenment, although the lessons from the Dalai Lama can be used in many, many situations. These compromises do take commitment and sacrifice, and many husbands do not have the minerals to see them through. However, Helen and Bryn, follow this advice and you too could be as happy as me and Tamsin. So there you have it. I've now nearly run out of things to say about the boring bastard, but not quite. So despite all of the obstacles that Bryn has put in front of himself over the years, he finds himself in the enviable position of having created a fabulous family, convinced a knockout woman to marry him, and he receives the love and support of a truly wonderful group of friends and family. Although most of us are only here because there's a free bar. I am truly honoured to have been your friend for over 33 years, Bryn, and even though I've given you a ribbing, I am so proud to be part of your celebrations today, and I do love you dearly. And I love Helen dearly now as well. It should be noted, though, that as your new bride, Helen is statistically the person who is most likely to murder you. However, despite this, I do wish you all the best of luck and all the happiness in the world. So without further ado, we come to the end of the speech. If you can all be upstanding,
yay.
That's everyone. Quick, give me a glass. Oh, don't matter. Anyway, I'll pretend. So, to the wonderful bride and groom, the new Mr. and Mrs. Showin! Yay! Thank you, everyone.
Been handed the mic again, didn't think I was going to say anything else, but basically, Bryn obviously hasn't been to the dentist for a while, but he did save it all up, so it's a free bar. So let's get pissed!
Hey! I found a love for me, darling, just dive right in, follow my lead. I found a girl, beautiful and sweet. I never knew you were the someone waiting for me. 'Cause we were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time. It's all I own, and in your eyes, you're holding mine. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, listening to our favorite song. When you said you looked a mess, I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it, darling, you look perfect tonight. Well, I found a woman stronger than anyone I know. She shares my dreams. I hope that someday I'll share her home. I found a love to carry more than just my secrets, to carry love, to carry children of our own. I know we'll be alright this time.
face. When I see your pretty face.